Welcome to the Penny Bloom Podcast. Ain't another place that has got more bombast. Romp past your mom, dad's listening to Tomcats. Talking everything that make you sad. We don't want that. We're here to make you smile. Put your mind at ease. Peace, love, and bloom, and always praise Keanu Reeves. This what we about. Get some weed and now. We'll talk until we can't no more, and then we peacing out. Alright, let's go. Penny Bloom Podcast. It's the Penny Bloom Podcast. Penny Bloom Podcast. It's the Penny Bloom Podcast. Penny Bloom Podcast. Penny Bloom Podcast.
Hello, everybody, and welcome in to the Penny Bloom Podcast. We are continuing our top 100 favorite Star Wars characters today, and this is part 6 of 7. We're doing rankings 11 through 19 today, starting with 19, working our way up to 11. I am Colton Robertson. I'm joined by Joseph George. What's up, homie?
Oh, what up, what up? Always a pleasure to be here.
Oh, and it's always a pleasure to have you. And for anyone joining us for the first time this week on this project, I can't blame you. You know, the top 20, it's the most intriguing. It's the most like, oh, yeah, who you got in the top 20? Well, you know, we've got tons of great characters in that bottom 80. Mm-hmm. You know, when it comes to Star Wars, I love all these characters from the bottom of the list to the top. You know, I got had some interactions on Twitter. I've been posting up on Twitter about like where everybody is. I'm running that down, and like someone had a particular problem with Cobb Vanth being as low as he was. And I was like, hey man, I love Cobb Vanth. Don't get me wrong. 85, there are like, I had 200 characters that I had to whittle down to 100. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like the fact that he's in the top 100 is a fucking, that means I like the guy, you know, like I had so many characters. So that said, if you're joining us for the first time, can't blame you. You're definitely getting in for the real meat of the matter here. All the biggest characters in Star Wars. But there are tons of great characters in the bottom 80 that we've discussed at length. So All that's there for you in parts 1 through 5. But it is time for part 6. Starting with 19, working our way up to 11. Would you like to kick us off today?
Oh, yeah. This is one that is a lot of mystery surrounding this character right now. Not why he is here. But I'll start with the last, I think, of the Rebels crew, and it is Ezra Bridger for me. I think Kanan was last, I believe, was my 20. And then now Ezra. Ezra will top the Rebels crew for me, but not the where is he now and what, you know, all the Ahsoka implications of, you know, why he's here. No, I really, Ezra was my favorite of the Rebels crew just because I felt like it was just through his viewpoints a lot, and we were learning through him, and it was a very interesting, not just light the whole time. Like there were, you know, questions of like with Ezra and Maul, their storyline, you know, is incredible, but also just Kanan and Ezra are amazing the whole time. And Ezra, like, I don't know, Ezra from the very start, like the way he even like forms his lightsaber, you know, like a gun and a lightsaber in one, like, I don't know, you just don't see that before. And like, it's
gnarly.
He's just very bright, and he's, I don't know, it's
very one of a kind, very original Jedi.
Yeah. Yeah. Just very unique. No, and I don't know, he's obviously important, to the Ahsoka storyline here, whether he's gone, dead, alive, more powerful, old, younger. I don't even know. I don't know what the heck's going on with Ezra.
I don't understand.
But no, anything we can do to get him in live action, I don't know. That's what I want to see.
I'm extremely excited for it. I've said this a couple times now. I've started our Rebels rewatch since I gave away all my Rebels picks at like basically the 40s. That's changed. They would have been easily 20s, maybe even this high. Like, I'm like, I feel remiss to have put them as low as I did. But
they're good. Yeah, they're
fucking good, man.
The family. It's such they a, are. I don't know. But
yeah, man, I love me some Ezra Bridger. I think that I put him a little bit too low for what, for how I feel about him now. You know, it took me a while to warm up to Ezra. I've had an interesting admiration for Ezra, you know, like, when I first watched Rebels, I thought I was much more fascinated by Kanan and Hera and their whole thing that they had going on. Those were definitely, that's like the crux of the show for me, the heart of the show for me. But upon the, I think this is my second rewatch of Rebels. I've rewatched it once and now I'm watching it again right now. And man, Ezra and Kanan's relationship is way more intimate than I ever ever really glommed onto. You know, there's this moment where, the season one finale of Rebels, whenever Kanan's under the impression that Ezra's dead and that he is free of fear to take on the Inquisitor. You know, the Inquisitor's like, what's up now? I just killed your homeboy. And he's like, you know, you just, now you're fucked. You just did it.
You don't know who you're messing with.
Yeah. Ezra, man. Just a great character. And the insecurities that character has, you know, I brought up last episode, when he's finding his Kyber crystal and he has this whole Force vision where he's back on the Ghost and he's overhearing a conversation between Zeb, Hera, and Sabine where Zeb's like, I just can't wait to have my room back to myself if he doesn't come back. That's going to be great. And Hera's like, don't say that. And Zeb's like, what? Don't act like you're going to miss the kid. And she's like, no, I am. And it's because he can provide something for our cause. That's all I care about. And Sabine's like, me, I pity him. You know, I feel bad for the kid. He's just a little kid, you know? And it's just like, and he's like, no, this isn't real. Like, that's not how they view him. He knows that they're his family, but that's how he fears they view him. That's his deepest insecurity from each of them. And I like, I just love that he recognizes them as his family by the end of season one. And it's just a wonderful, wonderful arc that character's gone on. And I can't wait for the future of him.
Oh yeah. No, I don't know if it's just the hologram and that's all we're getting for now. And it's maybe more of like a later down the road reveal. Who knows? But if Thrawn's coming this early, I don't know. I'd say Ezra.
If Thrawn's back, Ezra's got to be somewhere, you know?
Yeah. Just let it happen. I don't know. Maybe episode, I'm not hoping episode one. Maybe it's a big reveal, you know, maybe season one finale. I don't know. I don't know. But we'll see. I'm interested to see how they bring him in. But, but yeah.
All right. Well, then my 19, this is where I have my final character that has not appeared on screen. This is a comic book character with a couple of her own titular runs. Dr. Aphra.
Dr. Aphra. Did I spell it right? I did. That one's pretty
beautiful.
Pretty simple, though.
Yeah, no. Love me some Dr. Aphra.
Give her real name, though. I don't know if I could have got that.
Chelly Aphra. Yeah.
Chelly Lona. Lona Aphra. L-O-N-A. Mm-hmm. Middle name. Okay.
Yeah. Chelly Aphra. You know, wonderful, wonderful character. Indiana Jones in space. Archaeologist. Space archaeologist going from planet to planet. Kind of similar to Fee in that she is liberating ancient wonders, but much more... not so kind in terms of what she'll do with the artifacts at that. She's a little conniving. She'll do what it takes to get her score and she'll sell it to the highest bidder. She's about her money. You know, I'm returning it to the people who it rightfully belongs to. No, I'm a sell that shit. and she does take her stands. You know, she's not an Empire sympathizer or anything. She won't sell to the Empire. She faces the Empire on numerous occasions. She's got this anti-hero ambiguity to her that's really compelling. You know, you can tell she wants to be good, and she does her best to be good at most points, but she has a self-destructive tendency that screws her in the long run and the people she loves in the short term. Very, very like Saul Goodman, Tony Soprano sort of like, they have this thing to them where they're like, God, it would be so nice if I was just a good person, and I know I could be, but I can't help but keep doing the things that are ruining the people around me. And that's kind of Dr. Aphra's bag, and that's what makes her so compelling. She's a self-destructive mess, but she is caring and she is loving, and she shows these flashes of brilliance and I just really love the character. I think that's going to be, I'm praying one day we can get her folded into on screen, whether it's animation or live or live action. I just love me some Dr. Aphra. I think the comics have done her wonderful justice. She's one of my most read comic book characters, because I've read every issue of Dr. Aphra that exists at this point. But it's
okay.
Yeah, yes. she's got a bright future in Star Wars. I'm looking forward to whatever she has in store for us.
Don't know if you were, I don't know, for trying not to spoil something of her storyline, but I just see it, just a very big character that's involved with her. Like big bad guy enlisted.
Oh, Vader.
Like yeah. I don't know if you were trying to, but
yeah, that's kind of a launching off point for her character, is that she used to serve, like, not serve Vader, but they were, you
he
know,
says she was recruited by him after the Battle of Yavin.
Yeah. To kind of, you know, and I said she's not an Imperial sympathizer, and she doesn't believe in the Empire, but she'll, if it helps her get a buck, she'll go ahead and sell information.
Yeah, that is a lot of money.
Yeah, so Vader, and that's what's cool about her, too, is she spends the rest of the series, because that's kind of a launching off point for her character, okay. Vader being who recruited her. Semi-trying to atone for it, mostly running away from her fear of Vader. A lot of intersections with massive characters for the comic book original characters. You know, Dr. Aphra's had a lot of run-ins with, you know, the rebellion gang, like Luke, Leia, and Han. And all them. They've all crossed paths on a few times. But yeah, love me some Dr. Aphra. Homies with Black Chrysanthemum. She's got these two droids
at the beginning
of her run that are named 000, and I can't remember the astromech, but they're basically just like dark
C-3PO. BT, like B-E-E-T-E-E in text.
Yeah.
That's kind of funny.
BT, yeah, BT. Yeah. They are the dark counterparts to C-3PO and R2-D2. Like they are,
oh, that'd be
absolutely
sick.
No, they're like evil, and they're like killing machines. They're incredible at doing it.
That'd be awesome.
And like 000 is like incredibly menacing. Like, it's like, oh, you do not want to fuck with that protocol droid that murders people.
Wow. That'd be cool to see. Yeah, no.
But yeah, I love me some Dr. Aphra. She's had some great relationships with Magna Tolvan and Sana Staros. Really compelling representation in Star Wars 2. She's super gay. But yeah, she's a wonderful character, and I love Dr. Aphra. I'm looking forward to anything else we can get from her. So 19 Dr. Aphra. Love her.
Well, I'm going I guess I didn't mean for it to happen this way. It's kind of in a different pair, but it kind of paired well with Ezra, because this is where Maul is for me.
Ah.
And just, you know, being a prequel baby, this is, I don't know, what I opened. This is the first villain I saw, you know, big, or just in those movies, you know. You know this dude's just bad, and he's got that double lightsaber. As a kid, there was no cooler villain than Darth Maul to me. Like, honestly, like, I liked Darth Vader, and I was afraid of him, but I was honestly probably more afraid of Darth Maul. Like, I had more, like, actual kind of nightmares, I'd say, of Darth Maul, just because of how just scary he looked. You know, just devilish. Like,
yeah,
literally.
Scary motherfucker.
But more of, you know, my favoritism comes from, you know, I like him just because I'm a prequel baby, and that fight just between Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan and, you know, him is just ingrained in my brain forever. But now it's more of like the Clone Wars arcs and the Rebels arcs that he, I don't know, just the Mandalore, and him just trying to Kenobi, just Sam Witwer, just absolutely Kenobi. Owning the role as well, helps. And, I don't know, Maul has, I don't know if maybe, who knows, the spikes on the helmet, if they'll come back to him, who knows, one day. He's still alive, even through this Kenobi slice. Somehow they'll bring him back. No, he's gone. He better be dead.
No, yeah, he's done.
I swear to God.
Swear to God. No, he's dead. He's dead as fuck now. But yeah. No, yeah, one of those rare characters who makes their debut in live action, and then their most compelling story happens in animation. You know, it's it's not a common jump. You know, we see a lot of characters jump from animation to live action, but very rarely, you know, like I know Anakin, Obi-Wan, all the base characters did make the leap to animation for the Clone Wars, but even then they're, the bulk of their story doesn't happen in the Clone Wars. It happens in live action. Maul's the opposite. The bulk of his story, all of his story, you know, like, I mean, he hardly has a story in The Phantom Menace. His entire story happens in animation, which is super cool.
The Phantom Menace, it's just, here's my new apprentice.
It will be done.
Go kill, you know, he almost runs over Anakin and then has to fight Qui-Gon for a little bit, but then they just jump on the ship, get out of there. And then they, you know, obviously the fight there and that happens there. But
kills
Qui-Gon, that's about it.
Sliced in half by Obi-Wan and that's it.
There you go.
He
just had a shrine of Satine. Dude was just thriving off of the thought that he killed
Kenobi.
Like, just what a twisted preacher.
Very, very demented man. Another one that's had some great expansion in comics. You know, there's a couple great Darth Maul runs, mini series, and they're really, really well done. I've always really enjoyed the Maul comics, so I strongly recommend those as well. Kind of also, they kind of fill in some gaps from the Clone Wars. You know, I've talked many a time about the whole Rook cast and Gar Saxon going and finding Maul and ascending him to the throne of Mandalore. Essentially, that happens in comic books. That doesn't happen in the Clone Wars. That's a story.
But they're those characters are in.
They are also in Clone Wars.
Just those events don't happen.
Specific events where they go and get Maul and bring him back to Mandalore. That sort of thing, or like recruit him to their cause, that specifically happens in the Clone Wars. But not in the Clone Wars, in the comics, it's a hell of a story he's got, very long spanning, and I got to imagine that at some point we're spending a lot of time in this post episode 3 pre episode 4 timeline. He is running Crimson Dawn for a long time.
Isn't that like, I don't know. I feel like Maul's really not like that little post. Was it a post credit scene for Solo?
It was not a post credit scene. It was just part of the movie. But
I don't know. I feel like, I don't know. There's still something more to do with Maul.
Well, and again, I think that Disney is doing all it can to avoid Solo like a wildfire, which is ridiculous because there's so much from that movie that can be acted on and acted on compellingly, and I just can't believe they haven't.
But I don't know. But that's the thing, is that Maul's already here, where we got him now, and it's seemingly, you know, he keeps coming back somehow in stories.
Somehow Darth Maul has returned.
That's going to be, you know, it's not just Palpatine anymore. It's everybody now. They're getting everybody
all
back.
The Sith.
But I don't know, the Ezra, I didn't mean to put him next to Ezra. It just kind of, I guess, happened that way. But I don't know, kind of, there you go.
I love that. Yeah. Love that. My 18, I'm going back to the Rebellion. This is where I have Rogue One's Jyn Erso.
Oh, there she
love is. Me some Jyn. One of my all-time favorite characters in Star Wars. One of the best protagonists in any Star Wars movie or Star Wars anything for my money, as is displayed with her being top 20 here. I just love the journey that character goes on, even just over the course of that movie, going from this, you know, what she says to Saw in the middle of his base, you know, it's not a problem if you don't look up, about the Imperial flag flying over the galaxy, to being the one who goes to the center of the Rebellion and being like, we have to do this. You know, rebellions are built on hope. This is the key. We have to attack Scarif. Send everything you have. And ultimately they turn her down and she does it anyway. And that's like, she becomes an ultimate rebel over the course of that movie. And it's so cool to see. You know, I think that she's just got a great, just a fantastic performance by Felicity Jones as well as Jyn Erso. I think that's one of the things that really cinches that character there, is that it's just so wonderfully performed. God, I love me some Jen Erso.
You got to get that show. I don't know. Just get it. Yeah, get it out there somehow. Just
get it out there. Put it down on paper, man. No, I love the events of Catalyst, a Rogue One novel, and the Rogue One novelization, the way they key us in on Jen Erso's story a little bit more, her thought process and stuff, you know. Because there's this thing in the movie where you can't really tell that this is where her head's at, but in the book, in the novelization, Jen resents her father like crazy, resents Galen. Like, he left, he chose that over us, you know, like, what, why would he do that, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's not until that hologram message that she realizes she's had her dad wrong. So that's why she's flooded with emotion and is breaking down crying and stuff. Like, it's not just that she misses her dad and her dad's saying, oh, I never gave up. I've been fighting for you. Yeah. Everything I do for you. It's that she realizes he meant it when he said that, you know, everything I do for you. And I love that. I love that character. Love that story. And those final moments spent with Cassie and Andor, man, just a wonderful, wonderful, like, interesting parallel story there. Starting as like the looking out for yourself, don't worry about what the Empire's got going on, and then ultimately becoming the image of what the rebellion should be. Yeah, Jen's the shit, man. Love me some Jen. She reignited the passion for the cause that Cassian had, you know.
I mean, there's a reason one of the most beautiful Star Wars movies has her as the main character.
Yeah.
You know, the story is beautiful, and that's why that movie just, I don't know. We are blessed to have that movie, and that, I don't know, that strengthens Star Wars so much. Like,
oh, absolutely.
Like, I don't know, the plans that were handed off, you know, and, you know, I never really thought about what had to go into getting the plans of the Death Star. You know, I just always took, yeah, they had that, and they knew where to blow up the thing, and they blew up the thing, and they blew up the Death Star. But just the fight that alone that had to just get the plans in the first place, and the sacrifice, you know, like, how beautiful that story is, just for that alone, just that little itty-bitty, you know, piece of the Star Wars story. But yeah, I hope we get some flashbacks or something. I don't know. I hope Jen is involved somehow in live action again.
Yeah, man. Future. Well, that's what's interesting is that, like, there's also this thing where, like, the most compelling part of her story is the one that we saw, you know? Like, beyond that, it's mostly, I mean, like, she does a lot of cool shit with Saw over the course of their time together. So, like, that'd be what I would be looking for. But, yeah, man, there's a lot of good story to tell, I think, with her. And I, you know, they did tell us the story that if they never wanted to bring her back, they would have to.
Totally,
you know?
Fine.
But I would love to see more Jen, man. That'd be super cool. So yeah, I have a Jen Erso at 18.
Well, wow. Not at 18, it's my 17, but another Jen, I guess. I got Qui-Gon Jen here.
Mm.
So not quite Jen, but Qui-Gon. This is where where just so happened Maul and Qui-Gon, that was the duo I thought that was, like, I put here by a kind of accident, but then I'm like, oh, Ezra's kind of there too. But it was mainly just, Maul was above Qui-Gon, I think, at one point. And then I'm like, no, I'm like, I can't do that. You know, Qui-Gon's not in a whole lot, and there's a lot more, I think, with Maul that I like, but Qui-Gon is just the type of Jedi that I like. That's just very rare. The guy that isn't, he sees he's kind of like the good version of Count Dooku. If Count Dooku never went full blown
dark,
dark. He's just chill. He understands, like, where he is. He understands the flaws of, you know, the council and everything. And he saw the importance of Anakin, you know. And I just really like to think if Maul doesn't kill him here, you know, goes a whole lot different if Qui-Gon can train Anakin. The duel of the fates, you know, we get that fight. I say it's a fight, but it's not really just a fight. It's like you also get the score along with it. Like, that alone, just that one song is incredible. And Qui-Gon is the reason, you know, we talked about how, like, Ezra was thought to be dead, and Kanan was like, all right, now you fucked up. We get that with Obi-Wan, you know? He goes, well, now I kind of know. I mean, he saw him actually get stayed. You know, he's like, okay, this is not good. He's probably, I don't know. Just,
I'm
right now,
dead.
I gotta go. And we, I mean, come on. One of that block behind the back never gets old.
Always hard. Always hard, bro. Oh, it's the one I always think of immediately, you know? Like, the fact that Maul just pushes both sides of his sabers at the same time, you know, and just it's just such a clean choreographed fight, man. Mm-hmm.
But Qui-Gon there, he's peaceful at those doors, you know? Mm-hmm. He's sitting down, he's meditating. He knows, you know, right whenever they're about to come open. And I learned the reason for those doors just recently. And they actually, well, who knows if they actually planned this from the start. But I guess, like, that's like a reactor or something like that Maul fell into. Mm-hmm. And it's protecting, like, all the harmful, like, radiation that can escape the room. That's why there's multiple layers of, like, the lasers or whatever. And they need to let power out. They can open it and, like, actually, I guess that's what it's for, is, like, to keep it in. So I guess, like,
that makes sense.
If that's true, and it's, like, whatever. Like, what was, did Gideon just have, like, I don't know. Was that, like, I don't know. If Gideon, I guess.
I just took that as, like, layers of protection.
I think that was more of what he did it for. Was just like, yeah, we can't. I got guards in between each one as well, you know, sort of thing. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I don't know where I heard that the power thing, but
that makes sense.
I have no idea.
Just because, like, it is interesting. Like, why have these doors in this random spot, and why? Like, there's
got to
be a
reason. Some sort of power. Like that was like behind the hangar of you know,
the
it's like
Bay of Naboo. Yeah.
So it's like. Probably just like their power. I don't know, whatever the fuck
their power source.
How they generate power, and then it looked sick.
Yeah, super cool. Those like giant purple beams shooting up through the.
And in the Lego games, you could jump in them, and that's how you actually go up. It's like elevators. At least in the GameCube games, those are the Lego Star Wars games I know. At least when I refer to Lego Star Wars, that's I always refer to.
I'll never forget the like loop you like ran around with Maul, and like you had to like jump up all these different platforms and try to chase him up there.
And like, oh my god, yeah, oh man. And then the first time it was hard because you had to like, I don't know, whatever. But then you could just do it on story mode and do it with Jar Jar and just go up and it's no problem. But yeah, I don't know. But Qui-Gon, that's where this I guess originated from. But even I don't know, and like. Obi-Wan, we got Force Ghost Qui-Gon, you know, he's still popping up. We got Tales of the Jedi Qui-Gon. Mm. So I don't know.
Qui-Gon Jinn.
Yeah, not just Phantom Menace. I like more he's up there just for the kind of Jedi he is and what he stood for and like his values and stuff like that. So
I've got him on my list even higher than that, you know. Like I love me some Qui-Gon. He's a great character, and he'll be popping up before long for sure.
Had to put him above Maul. Couldn't let the guy kill him.
Couldn't let that happen.
Couldn't.
But at my 17, I'm taking it to the sequel trilogy. This is where I have Finn. FN2187. Love me some Finn. John Boyega did a fantastic job for performing Finn. And you know, I always talk about it every time Finn comes up because I can't blame anyone for feeling any sort of way about the way his story went. I do think marketing leads us one direction, led John Boyega one direction. I think he absolutely got screwed. But even so, removing yourself from what could have been, I think he still got one of the best arcs in all of Star Wars, from a First Order stormtrooper taken from his family at a young age and never actually giving in to their ways. You know, he was trained, he did all this, but then on his first mission, he doesn't do what he's been trained to do his entire life.
That was his first mission. He was just a janitor, you know, the whole, he just cleaned that. He didn't do anything bad at all. And then on his first mission, he couldn't do it. Like, that's such a good detail to, like,
love
include
it.
In there.
I love it, you know, and I think he watches his comrade die and scrape the blood across his face, and he's like, yeah, you know, the same for me, dog. I'm a figure a way out of this shit. Absolutely love that, you know, and there's this arc that I think is really, there's this line that's crucially important to his entire story, in the Force Awakens when Maz Kanata takes her glasses or her goggles and like turns them up and her eyes get real big and he's like, what's happening?
You live long enough. You see same eyes.
Yeah. These are the eyes of a man who is running. Yeah. Who wants to run, and he gives in and he's like, fuck yeah, I want to run. Have you seen the First Order? There's no way we stand a chance against them. Rey's like, yo, dude, what the fuck? And he's like, I mean it. Come with me, run away, everything will be fine. And even in The Last Jedi, that continues. He's ready to run, but he's ready to run to save Rey, which is, he's got a purpose at that point to save Rey. But then it comes back around through Rose Tico, making him realize what is important. Him going, okay, I need to save the Resistance. That is what I need to come back, and I need to help them figure this out. And I just absolutely adore that. You know, I think that he makes a choice. He decides he's done running. He becomes a Resistance fighter officially in The Last Jedi. And I think there's still plenty of story to follow up on with Finn. You know, I think that we, with the new Jedi Order movie with Rey, we're almost certainly gonna get John Boyega back as Finn.
Has he said anything yet? I know there's still
but there's been rumors. Yeah, there's been rumors. So I'm hoping, I'm holding out hope for it. But the fact that he hasn't said anything, a pretty outspoken guy, is a good sign to me.
Maybe it's kind of like a Han Solo, you know, like sort of thing, where like Harrison Ford he doesn't really care that much, but he did it, you know. And I don't think it's like that with John Boyega. I think like he'll come back. If he will come back, he'll come back like for Daisy Ridley.
Yeah.
And for just to get everyone back, you know. And like if, I don't know. I want to see just Rey, Poe, Finn, BB-8.
I want to see the whole group back together, man.
Yeah, Chewie.
Chewie.
Who else is up in there? Lando. Lando.
Yeah, all those characters popped up. Yeah, there's a lot of potential, man. There's a lot of potential, and a lot of potential of Finn's story. But even so, that arc from Stormtrooper to Resistance General, there's this part in The Rise of Skywalker where Poe and Finn, like Poe elevates Finn. He's like, I can't do this without you. You're going to be a general. And he's like, cool. And then they're like, you know, those like memes wherever like the jokes were like, doctor, doctor, doctor. And they're all like shaking hands. They like do it. But like general, they're like general, general. Mm-hmm. It's just like, it's just cute as hell. You know, I love Finn. I love Poe. I love their relationship. I love Finn and Rey. You know, I love that. There's that moment at the end of The Last Jedi whenever Rey does lift the rocks as she joked was all the Force was earlier in the movie. When she pushes them to the side, her and Finn just wrap each other up in like this giant hug. I just adore it. And I love me some Finn, so I have him here at 17.
Oh yeah. Okay, well, moving on. This is, I guess I don't know, maybe I'm really on to spoiling the people that I don't know, just talking about him before the pick, but this is where I have Han Solo, quite the drop from last time. I think last year I might have had him at like 7, I think, is where I had him, and now he's 16. So I don't know, it's, and I love, and then that's the thing. We just got done talking about like, man, Disney's trying to avoid Solo all they can, and why? It's such a great movie. And I agree. I love that movie. And like, I don't care that it's a different actor whatsoever. That's not like, and just the story that was told was great. And I never for once didn't think that was Han Solo on screen. So I have no beef with that. Alden Ehrenreich
did a fantastic job there.
There's no reason, like no hatred towards Han that caused him to drop. It is solely the love for other characters that has just grown stronger. So like, yeah, I mean, he's still in the top 20. He's above Qui-Gon Jinn, Maul, like Ezra, above the whole Rebels crew.
Yeah.
I love Han Solo. He's part of the core group, you know, like it's a character who we started out with, who, you know, the hero who didn't want to be a hero and never wants to, you know, he just hates.
That shot was one in a million, kid.
And I mean, hey, in the sequels too, you know, that no look shot there. I don't know. Maybe he's just been in the game that long. You know, he's like that. But I don't know. Maybe, or headcanon, if you just have sex with a Jedi, you know, Leia. You know, I don't know. Maybe it just
rubs off on you a little bit.
Literally, yeah. You know,
literally get force sensitivity.
I don't know. But it's just, I don't know. I don't want to think about it that way. But no, Han is just, this was the one that I was just so sad to see, like, fall this low. But then every character above, I'm just like, man, I really like the stories that they're telling right now. And, like, just the way I'm feeling for these characters right now is just a little stronger, which is insane.
I can't blame you. You know, Han did see a little bit of a drop for me as well. He was at 2 last year, and I don't have him top 2 anymore. I don't even have him top 5, but he will not be in this episode. I still have him top 10.
That's good.
But he did drop about the same amount as he did for you. You know, like, it's not it's not that it's anything Han did particularly. It's just that the love I've gained for a few other characters just grown exponentially. You know,
I mean, I've 3D printed 2 of his guns.
Yeah,
I've the Falcon. I printed that. I have, like, I don't know. So, like, I'm. It's not that
I. There's this loyalty I have to Han Solo, because when I was little, that was my guy. You know, when I was a young kid, fucking loved Han Solo.
Cool.
You know,
I mean, he's
the cool guy.
Yeah,
he was the cool guy, and I wanted to be Han Solo. So, like, I'll forever hold Han Solo in a really high regard. And what's interesting too is that, like, you know what? I'll save my Han Solo stuff for whenever I get to him. But yeah, I love me some Han. So that's, I like him there. And he actually works really well with my 16, because this is where I have Ben Solo, Kylo Ren.
Wow. Okay.
This is where I have his son. Love me some Kylo Ren. Love me some Ben Solo. I think that, if there's anything from the sequels, universally, everyone was like, yeah, that was dope. It was Ben Solo. It was Kylo Ren. His journey back to the light, the conflict that character faced, just a really, really well-performed character by Adam Driver as well.
I know what I have to do, but I don't know if this.
I know what I have to do, but I don't know if I have the strength to do it.
And I don't know. That Rise of Skywalker, that ending, man. Like, after rewatching the sequels again, just like how grand that ending was. Like,
dude, man, I love, like, the end of the, I love the sequels, man. Yeah. I shamelessly, unabashedly adore those movies, and I think that, you know, he used to be my, I never regarded him as my favorite. I did after the Rise of Skywalker. I was fairly certain Kylo Ren was, like, a top 5 favorite character of mine in Star Wars, and like, fresh off of that movie, because, I mean, that scene between him and Han in The Rise of Skywalker, that's one of my favorites, period. That, the way that parallels, and whenever he, like, breaks, and it's, like, official, and he goes, Dad, and Han goes, I know.
The fact that it's, okay, I feel like we've talked about this before, but, like, Leia is, this is her, like, act, doing, like, connecting. Is she connecting actual Han with Kylo here? Or is this Leia projecting herself as Han?
It's neither. It's neither. Leia,
I remember this,
in the
actually.
Moment...
I remember you. Okay. No, but yeah. I need the explanation.
The way
again.
That
I
do it.
Okay.
The way that I always look at the scene is that Leia, in the moments before her death, so in The Rise of Skywalker, they had a lot of heavy lifting to do with Carrie Fisher's role, given that she didn't get to film anything for it because she'd passed. They'd only used footage previously shot from The Force Awakens or The Last Jedi, mostly The Force Awakens, and plugged it into The Rise of Skywalker lines she'd already read and everything, which is why some of the dialogue at the beginning feels a little slanted, but they do a pretty good job at it anyway, but, regardless, I don't think they had a shot of Leia that would have been good enough to be convincing. There's this moment whenever Leia projects herself and she goes, Ben. And Kylo, during the fight with Rey, like, turns around and we don't see what he's looking at. He is looking at Leia, but we don't see her there, which kind of causes a disconnect in terms of what was happening. She did the same thing Luke did. At the end of The Last Jedi, Force projected herself. But I think it's in that moment, the way Han Solo surfaces, it was an interesting story choice, just because in a galaxy with Force ghosts where the dead can reconvene with the living, it becomes a little unclear. I really do think it's just Kylo's consciousness coming back to speak to him and surfacing in a way that is Han Solo. Like, he's making peace with himself by making peace with his worst deed, you know, mm-hmm. and recognizing yeah. that his father would have forgiven him. His mother would have forgiven him. They always loved him. And even so, his father did forgive him. That moment when after he stabbed mm-hmm. him, Han like brushed yeah. his face. Like, mm-hmm. he's, I think it's just an idea that he knows his parents loved him. He's realizing it fully, and it surfaces as Han Solo just being there in his head.
I think I do have him a little bit later this episode, actually. But surprisingly, I last list, I remember I had Kylo well above pretty much everyone else in the sequels. And that I'm like, this is the storyline that I like and that I don't have really any gripes with already. I like, but... interestingly enough, he's not the top sequels character for me anymore.
There you go. There you
go. So I will give that away, but he will come this episode.
No, what was interesting about mine this year is that I have Kylo at 16, Finn at 17, and last year I had Kylo at 18, Finn at 19. So they were always always been back to back, but they both saw just a tiny little jump there by two spots. And love me some Kylo, man. I think I think those are two great characters, and someone brought up like a really great idea for the story that like we'll never get now, which is a shame, but like this enemies to best friends story that could have been between Finn and Ben, which could have been really interesting. Like the way they faced each other at the end of The Force Awakens, and then they could have gotten a rematch where it's like sparring basically. You know, not actually fighting, but like that could have been
with
really
two
compelling.
Blue sabers. Yeah. You know? Yes. Oh man.
And, you know, we still have like, that's what I'm holding out hope for with Adam Driver's Ben Solo, is that like, I'm hoping that's the most active we've ever seen a Force ghost in a story, with the new Jedi Order. Kind of hoping he's just around and can just kind of be there, talk to everybody, teach from that's what's interesting about Force ghosts is that like we're now at a point where
is that what they mean by bringing everyone back?
All right,
getting everyone in on the picture. You know, we actually have Samuel L. Jackson, Mark Hamill, Liam Neeson, Yoda, all the Jedi come back as Force. I guess I would, you know, I don't know. I wouldn't be upset, you know, to see them all again. I don't know. That maybe just Force ghosts are a little more active, you know, and the more connected you are with the living person, the easier it is for you to, you know, show up. So maybe that's why Kylo can't show up so easily, because he's a dyad to Rey, and maybe that doesn't stop just because Kylo is dead.
No,
you know,
one's ever really gone. You know?
Yeah, so. I don't know. I think there's a lot more to the guy.
I think it'd be a good way to bring Adam Driver back. I think it'd be a good way to give Ben Solo redemption beyond the grave, is to kind of help teach the next generation, have conversations with other Jedi beyond Rey, like having a conversation with Finn in the new Jedi Order. I think that could be a really cool, compelling idea, both of them having been in the First Order, one of them obviously having done terrible, heinous things compared to the other, but regardless, both having come from the First Order, not now seeing the light, but they're both on the good side now. Like, it's an interesting idea. So, Ben Solo here at 16. Love the kid.
All right. Well, at 15, she climbed a whole lot, I think. I don't even know where I had her last. Let's see. I'm actually interested. But this is where I have Bo-Katan at 15. This season of Mando definitely helped that. For sure. Bo-Katan, and I think maybe I just didn't really pay attention to her story when I was watching Clone Wars and stuff before. Like, she's just a massive character, like, when it comes to Mandalore. And it's this season has helped me realize that. Like, whenever I'm going back and watching some of these arcs, I've had just, you know, I've let the Clone Wars just run a little bit sometimes when I'm watching these Ahsoka arcs, and I just like to watch a little bit of Clone Wars, and I'm like, man, I kind of forgot how cool Bo-Katan was, like, and just how many different, like, groups and just different storylines that she's had. Yeah, she's had so many different storylines, and I think my favorite is just, I like seeing her, you know, as live action. It's still Katie Sack. You know, it's, I don't know. It's, I love this way that they can bring animation characters into live action and keep it as, you know, the, just yeah. whoever voiced them, just bring them in because they have the acting experience too. It's, they casted them probably knowing that, you know, I don't know, just like
in some
we
ways.
Want experienced actors and it probably just helps, I don't know, just to have just both voice acting and real acting experience. And they just so happen to have a lot of really good voice actors. And for the Bad Batch, like William or young William, I forget his real name.
Oh, Jimmy Simpson.
But like, I don't know. It makes me like, and Wanda Sykes and stuff like that. Like I don't know, like just casting these people, is it for, you know, like maybe one day they have, yeah, like, right. it's priming them, you know, like getting them into the Star Wars universe, like getting them used to their character a little bit to get the voice down. And then they come in and bam, you know, you see them in live action, whatever. But no, Bo-Katan, man, she could have climbed higher, but it's just, it's really hard to put her above some of these people right now. Like, I think she has definitely the potential, to go there in the story that she got. And I think you're right in saying that, like, we don't need any more, that what she did, it feels complete, and that we don't, it was a very happy ending. But what comes next, I think, is really interesting.
And when I've talked about, leaving the story where it's at, I mean more with Din and Grogu. Bo has a lot of challenges to face in her future, I think, and I think that could be a really compelling story continuing forward. I know for a fact we'll get more stories with all of them. I don't hold out.
They're already calling it the Mandoverse.
Yeah,
I think
dumb as hell.
Mandoverse.
Yeah, like it's Star Wars.
Yeah, like, is it?
It's just that period of time.
Like, it feels like they're keeping it separate from the Star Wars stuff still, you know, like it feels like because Thrawn and all the Rebels people are coming up that it is like a separate entity, but I don't know.
No,
I hope not.
Yeah, I don't think, I think they're just, it's just a popular name.
Yeah,
I don't think
it works. I guess it rolls off the tongue well.
I get what they mean. It just drives home this sort of divide, and I don't like it. I don't like the divide there. I think it's just Star Wars. It's the Star Wars universe, actually. It's the Mando timeline.
We're just in a galaxy as well, actually. Yeah. It's just one galaxy.
But yeah, Bo-Katan, good choice there. I have her a little bit later in this episode, and you know, you mentioned her coming above. You couldn't quite put her above certain characters, and got her above my 15. My 15 is where I have Anakin Skywalker, Darth Vader.
Okay.
Yeah.
Here we go.
Love me some Anakin. You know, I think it's his story is Star Wars. You know, it's as a prequel baby, I loved Anakin when I was younger, and I've grown to really, really enjoy Anakin as a character and Darth Vader. Darth Vader is one of the most iconic villains of all time. I just, I can't really explain it. You know, I think that the novelty factor, it's worn off, you know, like Anakin has just been a constant. His story is just set in stone. It is what it is. I've always known it. I've always loved it ever since I've been a Star Wars fan. It's been the same story the entire time. And I've really, really enjoyed that story, and I really, really like it. But there's this thing about Anakin where I love him in moments, and there are a lot more moments where I'm like, I'm just not fucking with this dude. And I know it's because he's manipulated and he's being fucked over and all this stuff. He's being used like a pawn, to an extent. There are certain actions he takes that are his choice.
That was on him.
That's on him.
And I guess, you know, if you remove Palpatine, is he a different person? Yes.
Completely. Oh yeah, absolutely.
But he's still definitely got conflict in him, like without a doubt. And I mean, I got him a little higher up, that's for sure. Won't come this episode.
I figured not. But that's the thing is that like I love this character. You know, I do think this is.
I get where you're coming from. Yeah, no, like yeah. Totally.
He
yeah.
is Star Wars. I think there's this element to him where it's the way I felt about Revenge of the Sith. You know, Revenge of the Sith in the long term, probably the most rewatched movie I've ever watched of Star Wars. I haven't watched Revenge of the Sith nearly as much as I have other Star Wars movies in the last couple of years. So like, there's just this element to it where like, it's not like I've gotten tired of it. It's just that I've finally gotten to a point where I appreciate everything else so much more. It's affected it in a way where like, it just kind of slips down the ranking a little bit. And it's not an indictment of the character or of the movie. It's just a reflection of the evolution of the way I felt about Star Wars. And, because at a point, Anakin, shit, when I was younger, yeah, I'd have been hard pressed to tell you Anakin wasn't top two with Han Solo. You know what I'm saying? Like, that was,
Yeah. I mean, hey, me and my brother, we always fought. I was Obi-Wan, he was Anakin, but deep down, I'm like, if I could look like anyone, though,
if I could look like Anakin, I'd look like Anakin.
God damn. Let me look like, yeah. So, I mean, yeah. I liked Obi. I was more of the goody goody, I guess. Mm-hmm. Like, Obi-Wan, that's where I, you know, sided, but like, nah, Anakin, he was the Han Solo for me. He was like, I just didn't want the anger issues, you know. Mm-hmm. I'm like, man, if I could have Anakin's power, like his ability, yeah. You know.
And, you know, my perspective on just like the characters I love and the stories I enjoy has just evolved a lot. When I was younger, I loved villains. Like I was like, like when I watched The Incredibles, I loved Syndrome. I loved all these characters. So like, yeah. I was younger. I was a big, like my brother was Obi-Wan. I was Anakin, you know, like that was the shit that we did. And, not because he was like, oh, I don't want to be Anakin. No, we fought over that and I won. I was Anakin.
That's what the fights were. Yeah. Yeah, whoever won the fight kept Anakin. Yeah.
We had the pre-fight fight, you know, yeah, no, I loved that character when I was younger. I always thought he was just the coolest character. I thought just the way that character evolved and the way my perspective has evolved over time has led me to a point where I'm like, you know what? I'm all right sliding him down the list a bit. I do think that he's a great character. Of course, one of the best stories, period, in modern mythology. Is Anakin Skywalker, the tragedy of Anakin Skywalker. But yeah, just, there are a lot of characters who on a personal note, I enjoy the characteristics of a bit more. From here on in, I don't have a single person who you could go, oh, they have dark side tendencies. My top really? 14 are all good guys. There's no,
wow. There's okay, no, let's see. I got one, two, three, four. Yeah, I got four.
Well, that's just where my preferences lie, you know. Like so, like this is the highest villain-ish character I have.
Cool. Which makes sense. The most human-ish and manipulated and not really his
top two
fault,
villains: but, Kylo Ren, Darth Vader. You know, like they're one after the other. That's I love sick. Those characters. Yeah. I like that there's something so interesting about the contrast between those stories where Anakin, you get like a much more lifelong intimate look at, or a lifelong look at just his entire journey and his entire, devolution. Kylo's is much more succinct. And they do it the opposite way, you know, where I guess they don't do it the opposite way.
Kinda, yeah. We see him. Bad first. Well, the prequels came. I guess.
Technically, we did with Anakin.
You're right.
But
the way we watched
it.
That's
where I was like, well, wait a second. But yeah, to me, growing up a Star Wars fan with the prequels already basically existing, Anakin started good and turned bad. You know what I'm saying? Like, I know that's not how it was for everybody, but it was how it was for me. Started good and became Darth Vader. What's up?
Thought of the possibility of prequels for the sequels. Do they go that crazy, you know? Is that, or maybe not a trilogy, but like maybe like we're jumping what 20 or how many years in the future?
27 years after Return of the Jedi.
Maybe that movie, and then it's ended,
Oh, you know, maybe after like, the Rise of Skywalker?
Yeah. Like, we get, like, this next movie that's coming out. Rise of Skywalker, yeah, so yeah. It's, like, 15 years, and maybe, like, we get that story and whatever it happens to be. And then maybe, like, the next movie that they go is actually going back, like, before. And I don't know, maybe showing Kylo and Luke training. I don't know. I mean,
I think there's a lot of potentiality there for a story there. I think that an animated story about
that's
these core characters.
Animation. This, yeah,
dude, yeah, because
I don't
like,
know why I need it to be a movie. Yeah, just
no, yeah, like, and even so, like, shit, animated movies, I would never mind. But even so, they wouldn't do that. Animated shows, though, you know, I think that there's a lot of moving parts. Leia's spot within the Galactic Senate, her recognizing the rise of the First Order and forming the Resistance could be told. Luke training Kylo and his devolution in the dark side. Snoke lurking in the background, speaking to Kylo in his mind, Rey's relationship with Dathan and Miramir, her parents, and how they're on the run from Ochi of Bastoon and stuff. Lando's daughter was kidnapped by the First Order, and he didn't know who she was kidnapped by at a very young age. So, like all the characters in the sequels have very compelling stories between the original trilogy and the sequels. So, like, I think it would just be a missed opportunity to not do something like that. And even in an anthology format, you know, I'd prefer a narratively linear story, but an anthology format, you would too... never.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I'd get mad about it, but
saw a tweet that was like, someone was griping like, "I need more of these characters in live action. Like, I just need it." And it's like, oh, if only there was a way to easily incorporate many, many characters and like storylines and have it, you know.
I'm just like, I think deep fake technology and all that is really fascinating. It's really interesting, but just stop it.
Either it was. Yeah, that's what it was. It's like, I can't wait for deep fake technology to get so good so they can bring Luke Skywalker and Carrie Fisher and all these people back. And it's like, I don't want that.
Just get, you have Mark Hamill, who still has a voice, can still speak and voice acts all the time.
Could someone still there that looked Skywalker. Exactly like Mark Hamill did 30 years ago? Like, there was another tweet I saw. I was like, they got an actor that looked exactly like Mark Hamill did during that time that could play young Luke Skywalker for a long time. He is young right now in real life. Yeah.
Well, that's
he was
the thing.
Right there.
If they're so like, if they're so concerned about the reception of recasts, like for some reason their idea in Disney's head is that Alden Ehrenreich was a failure, which is not true. If that's the problem they have, then stop telling stories with those characters in live action. You have so much time to cover that's with fair. Other characters. You know, like you don't need to tell those stories then. I know they sell. But guess what? If you made an animated series about those characters, it'd get fucking watched. I'll tell you that. Yeah. Like,
man. Wow.
Yeah, man. I don't know. But I think that post Return of the Jedi, pre the sequels, would just be a great opportunity. You know, I was talking about how Ben could come back and talk to Rey as a Force ghost. There's got to be stories where Anakin came back and talked to Luke. You know?
Oh.
We've never seen that.
For sure. Like,
you know, 100%. It's got to be a thing.
Would he talk to... Okay. Wow.
Can't recommend the novel Shadow of the Sith enough. Strongly recommend that. It's a little tidbit there. Anakin and Luke actually have an interaction, which is very cool.
Well, you have Invader here and Anakin. It just so happens that my next person is Padme. So, I mean, it's not lining up, you know, on the same level exactly, but right the there. Order just worked out pretty well. Here and another character that is crucially underutilized, I'd say, for who she is, and like I don't know, she's kind of like the Leia before Leia was a thing because I don't know, she's Leia's mom,
within the timeline,
like just a pure badass every single time, like you see, like she is doing so much around the galaxy, like the one that's actually putting in the work, like everyone else that's in the Senate is just. Cashing their check
Cogs
and going to the meeting. Yeah, just doing their thing. But Padme's the one that's actually going out there, seeing what's wrong, and helping. And I don't know, I think, like, Clone Wars, it might just be the best, sadly, like, the best Padme just because you actually just get to see her do that stuff a lot. But I mean, Natalie Portman in the prequels, I mean, just the whole bait and switch of, you know, protecting, or like, I don't know, the queen and Padme and the whole, I don't know, that like, just, and the love, like the whole love story from just seeing like Anakin walking in, like, oh, are you an angel? And they're just, they're automatically, you know, a thing from sight, and them rolling around in the flower fields, like their wedding, you know, or them, I don't know, I guess secret wedding and all.
Yeah.
I don't know. Padme is, she was my childhood crush for quite a long time. I'd say there's not anyone that got above Padme.
Yeah, no, same, man. Padme was always a lovely, lovely lady, a wonderful character. And yeah, I've got her a little bit in here in a little bit before the end of this episode. So I will also be talking Padme before long.
Wow.
But yeah, that's the Queen of Naboo, you know. That's it's a wonderful, wonderful character. But yeah, 14. I'm gonna stick with you in the Phantom Menace realm, and I'm gonna go Qui-Gon Jinn. Got him above Anakin and Kylo and all that. Love me some Qui-Gon. You know, I think that he's one of the, all the reasons you said. He's the ideal Jedi, you know? Like, he's just questioning of the Order enough to be free-thinking, but not so questioning of the Order that he ever thinks, man, I need to do the opposite of that. Mm.
Is it Stellan Geos? Is that the super chill? Is that the one I'm thinking of, or am I mixing up?
I think you're thinking of Orla Jereni, like the Wayseeker.
No, the guy who's asexual.
Oh, that's Leox Giassi.
There it is. Okay, yeah, that's like the closest comparison to Qui-Gon I can make. Yeah. That's like, he's not quite there to Leox's level. You know, Leox is the most chill,
the most chill being, I think,
in the Star Wars universe. But Qui-Gon, he's like the closest to that the Jedi Order seems to have.
Yeah, there's actually a Dooku's apprentice before Qui-Gon, Ryel Avaros, who Qui-Gon has a few interactions with in the book Master and Apprentice, which is kind of my premier Qui-Gon content outside of the Phantom Menace, where Ryel is a much more matured Jedi Master who is very, very, very free thinking. He was inspired by Dooku in a great deal. Didn't go dark or anything, but he was questioning of the Order in the way that he was like, I can fuck if I want to. That dude was laid back as hell. Very, very chill guy.
Nothing. I guess it's just attachments that is not allowed. I guess like you can. So he was just like,
he was like, yeah,
without attachment.
There's nothing. Like, there's nothing without. There's no problem with getting laid, you know.
Okay.
He also had like a deep Southern or deep Texas accent. But there's nothing. There's nothing wrong with getting laid every now and then. You know, that ain't no problem. And Qui-Gon like walks in on him with a woman at one point, and he's like, "It's no big deal. She was just leaving." And she's like, "Okay, well, yeah, I'll get out of here."
Chill.
But yeah, Qui-Gon. I love Qui-Gon. You know, I think that. That character has a great, rich history, and I love that we got expansion on him with Tales of the Jedi. He's always just been a really, really laid-back and understanding dude, you know? I think that he's got a level head on his shoulders, and just one of those rare characters that no matter how he goes about things, you always feel like he's probably right. He's like, well, if Qui-Gon thinks it, it must be the way things are supposed to go. Not a lot of characters have that sort of 100%. Yeah, you did this good.
He knew Anakin was the chosen one off.
Mm-hmm.
Just, I don't know how he knew. He felt it. You know, he sensed it. He was very, in the first one to kind of go on that. Was he the first to go on the Force Ghost? Like kind of with the, forgot what that in the Clone Wars, like that storyline about how, like,
yeah, with like
he tipped Yoda off or something, maybe like he tipped Yoda to go on that path. That's what it was.
He did. But yeah, what's interesting about that Master and Apprentice book though is that it dives into how him and Count Dooku used to just pore over the prophecies. Like, they would it's not something the Jedi teach a lot. And Qui-Gon just took a deep fascination with the prophecies and the sort of the ideas of Jedis of old who thought they sensed something in the Force and knew there was some sort of thing that was important in the future. And there's this one prophecy that is acted on in Master and Apprentice that's like when the Kyber that is not Kyber appears, the time of the Chosen One has arrived. And and it's like, and the whole book is spent like him kind of poring over that, like, what does that even mean, the Kyber that is not Kyber? And then I've talked to you about the colon crystals, these orange lightsabers, these orange crystals that are very, very similar to Kyber, that are not Kyber, that act in a similar way. And that's the Kyber that is not Kyber. So he's all of a sudden like, yo, the time of the Chosen One is pretty much here, right? Like, and so that might be part of why he is so inclined to believe Anakin is the Chosen One, is that like, he's like, this is it. This is the one. I found it. This is it. Now, how he knew exactly who it was, that's impressive. But yeah, love me some Qui-Gon Jinn, man. He's a hell of a character. Turned down a seat on the council to keep being Obi-Wan's master, which is really cool.
What a guy.
What a guy. What a guy.
Qui-Gon. Yeah, never get enough of Qui-Gon. And you know, we got him as a Force ghost in Obi-Wan. And what was the conversation there that was had? It was like,
yeah, it was basically like, Master Qui-Gon. He's like, took you long enough. You know, he doesn't. That's this whole,
right.
Come with me, Obi-Wan. We have much to learn.
Just a nice line, I guess, in general.
I have a very particular set of skills.
Yes, that's what he teaches him. Yeah. Exactly.
I will teach you how to save my daughter. Countless weird terrorist attacks.
Well. Qui-Gon Jinn. Well, yeah, not too far off. Only three or two people in between. So just a three-person gap.
Right there.
Yeah, okay. And another person that you just mentioned that's coming up for me now is Ben Solo / Kylo Ren for me. Yes, still not the top sequel character any longer for me. But still very, very close to it.
Very high.
Because, man, was just his whole conflict, like you were right, everything you said, the conflict that he was constantly facing, and then, like, the back and forth of hearing that Luke lied to Rey, you know, like, about how it went down, or not necessarily lied, but left out some details, you know, of how the night went down, and then, like, getting Kylo's version of it, and then back to the, you know,
the actual middle ground actual version. Story.
Yeah, and so, like, that whole addition, like, he just strengthened a lot of storylines. Like, the conflict, his storyline, like, with Rey, the dyad with him and Rey, like, was so good. And that, a part that I didn't catch before, like, that I thought that Snoke or Palpatine was behind that dyad thing. And, like, that, you know, because he's like, yeah, I linked your minds together, and I'm every voice you've ever heard. But then whenever they show up there and Palpatine's right there. He's like a dyad in the Force. Like, how, what a rare thing. Like, he's shocked at it. Which is interesting. And I don't know if that's maybe just to show that Palpatine or that Snoke isn't just a pure puppet, you know, that he does act on his own and has his own will and everything. Which is really interesting if so. If not, like, I don't know. I don't know what that means. If Palpatine linked their minds, and that's maybe what, like, started this I don't know. Like, he didn't realize that they were a full dyad, but he linked, like, linking their minds is something different than a dyad. You know, like, he linked their minds and so that they could talk and everything, but, like, the fact that they can actually pass things along
It kind of unlocked something. Like, it was kind of like they didn't know how to do it. Then Snoke did it, and then they were like, oh shit, like, I'd be willing to bet he only linked their minds the first time they linked. And then they just knew how to do it from then on. Although in The Last Jedi, they do seem kind of surprised every time it happens, except for the time that she goes after Luke told him the story. She actually goes and reaches out to him. I'd be willing to bet that's when the dyad was like unlocked.
That's interesting. Know? Yeah, I wonder if they get into that. Like, I guess she's going to be training a lot more in the Force, and like in hopefully if Kylo's there, and I don't know, a Force ghost, we get. I don't know. I that would be really cool to dive into. But yeah, that's, I don't know, part of the sequels that I was never, you know, that I never disliked at all. But now rewatching it, it's only gotten even better. Kylo and Ben, I like, I don't know, just Ben Solo, I feel like is just the,
and it's even that detail is enhanced by the show Obi-Wan Kenobi, like why Leia would be willing to name her son after Ben Kenobi, you know, like that's a pretty cool little detail, you know, like that she is willing to name her son Ben, and not just her son but Han's son, you know, like there's the events of A New Hope where Ben sacrifices himself to let them get away and stuff, like,
mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
Ben's a huge part of their life. And I love that detail that they named their son Ben Solo has always been so cool to me. I've always loved that. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I love me some Kylo and Ben. So you're definitely not going to hear a peep out of me for him being at 13 there. That's a great choice. Great choice. But I'm actually heading back to the OT. Heading back to the original trilogy, and his deal just keeps getting worse all the time. This is where I have Lando Calrissian. Love me some Lando. This is one of those dudes who, this is one of those characters where it's just a pure preference on my part. There's not been a lot in the story that has made me gone, Lando, what a fucking guy. I love him. I've just always loved him. You know, ever since I watched Empire Strikes Back and then Return of the Jedi more particularly, is where I start to really love Lando. They must have heard about my maneuvers at the Battle of Tanab. Just a hell of a guy, man. I love me some Lando Calrissian.
You know how you said that, like, in Mando, Greef Karga was kind of imitating, like, the acting back then in, like, the original trilogy Star Wars? Yeah. Like, Lando is, like, a perfect example of, like, a voice like that. You know, kind of like a, just the grandiose, you know, I mean, he's got, you know, his whole city. He's leading that whole, he's got to be. He's like, basically, I don't know, the magistrate, kind of, I don't know, he's kind of, yeah.
The administrator.
And I don't know, it's just, his voice is so good. Like, just the way he talks and everything. Yeah, no, he's just a cool dude. Like, we're talking about cool dudes. This guy's
the smoothest motherfucker in the galaxy.
Smooth. That's a good word. He's smooth.
Yeah, that man's got the suave. Mm-hmm. That dude's nice with it. I love me some Lando. He's got the best sense of style in the galaxy besides Padme Amidala.
Fair.
Yeah, those are top two though. They know how to dress, brother.
Yeah.
Lando, love me some Lando. Love Billy D. Love Donald Glover. Mm-hmm. Just both wonderful examples of a great performance of a character that translates really well in terms of the recasting and stuff. I've just always loved me some Lando, and
never like, oh, that's not Lando. Like when I was watching that, like that's just, I don't know. Like it's Donald Glover, and I don't know. Maybe that was the only thing that was taking me out of it. Actually, was like I'm just a bigger fan of Donald Glover, but like it's just like he's playing the character of Lando. You know, I really hope that they're not up on that. Like just. They think Solo's a failure because of that. Like,
they announced that Lando series a couple years last year at some point, and I'm hoping that they've never said that that's not in development. They're just like they're waiting for Donald Glover to go ahead and free up. He's been a very busy man.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, that's
so. There's only a matter of time, I think, before we finally continue some Lando stories. I would really enjoy that, but. Yeah, love me some Lando Calrissian, and I was speaking to that book, Shadows of the Sith. Mm. Incredible story that Lando has in that book. That's where we learn that his daughter was kidnapped, and that's why it's all the more reason I think Janna from The Rise of Skywalker is his daughter.
Janna?
She's the chick they meet on the Endor, who he goes like, who's your family? And she's like, I don't know. And he's like, let's find out. Yeah, you know, like I think that's his daughter, because the First Order notoriously.
Why have that line there? Yeah, that is an interesting. like thing to include there.
It's either it's setting up a spinoff series, or it's just alluding to the fact that that is Lando's daughter. Lando's daughter was kidnapped by the First Order, and he spends years and years and years trying to find her. And he doesn't know that she was taken by the First Order. He just knows that she was kidnapped at a very young age.
Dude, that works out so well.
Oh, yeah.
Works out too well.
And that's what the First Order did. They kidnapped children and raised them within their ranks to be soldiers. That's what happened to Finn. That's what happened to Janna. I'm assuming that's what happened to Lando's daughter. And he spends years trying to find her. And then he gets on the trail of a guy named Ochi of Bastoon, who's got this... who's got this kidnapping plot going right now. And he knows that if he can help this family, these two parents and their daughter, that maybe it can lead him to his daughter. And those parents and their daughter is Miramir and Dathan. The daughter's Rey. And he's like, so that's what leads to the events of The Rise of Skywalker, where he's like, me and Luke actually looked for Exegol for a bit. And we never found it. You know, the trail went cold on Ochi of Bastoon around here on Pisana, you know, like, so.
Dang, that's
if you're already on a high point with the sequels, that book does fucking wonders. Like Shadows of the Sith enhances everything about that book, enhances Palpatine, enhances Ochi of Bastoon, enhances Rey's story and her parents, because it actually goes into Dathan's past as a clone growing up on Exegol. Book.
Well, goddamn. Well, I mean, we can continue the talk, I guess, because I put a lot of people together, I guess. But this Rey and Ben Solo, I just kind of felt right. I feel about the same about both of them. It's not that, like, I said that Ben isn't the top sequel character anymore, but really, like, Rey is only above him because, like, she was just good the whole time. Like, I don't know. She had the thoughts, but she kept, I don't know. She always kept on the light. And just the innocence of her at the beginning as well. Like, just completely unknowing of anything. The scene with her and Maz of her, like, actually being like, you know the truth. You know, like, you know what happened, like, that they're...
The belonging,
like,
you seek is not behind,
like,
you.
And I don't know, like, the innocence of her. Yeah, that's where I was going. I didn't know there was this much green in the whole galaxy. Like, even that, like, the innocence of that alone. Like, she was just on Jedha, just a scrapper, like, just trying to get by, like, getting food or portions. Quarter portion, you know, for all that scrap, like, all that work she had to do. And it's just a little water bread. Like, I kind of look good, like, little water bread muffin. I don't know, I kind of want to try that.
I want to try that shit. It looks yummy.
Like, I feel like they can make that technology a thing eventually. I don't know. But, I don't know, Rey is, there's a reason she's the main character of sequels. And I was just blinded by, you know, the sequel hate and everything and Palpatine, all that stuff.
It's hard when you hear so many things from people you think you should trust.
You know, and I saw a tweet that was like, how could Rey fly so well? Where did she learn to fly?
And where did Hera?
And I was like, okay.
Where did Hera? Where did Poe?
Let's look at everyone's prime boy, Anakin Skywalker. That dude did nothing but pod raced, and then he hopped in a Naboo starfighter and blew up the fucking Trade Federation's blockade. By himself, he went in there and blew that shit up.
Yep.
That's a kid. And Rey, even in the movie, she, like, grazes against mountains and shit. Like, she's making mistakes. Like, it's not like she's flying perfectly. It's not like she's flying like Poe and doing all that shit, you know? Like, you see Poe, an experienced, you know, flyer, do that shit, and you're like, okay, that's a fly, you know, that's a pilot. And then you see, like, Rey does some cool stuff. She's also a Palpatine. Like, she's Palpatine's granddaughter. Like, she has massive force capabilities. Like, I don't understand how, like, people, like, keep forgetting about, like, the force and everything. And I don't know, like,
it's
not real life at all. And, like, I don't know, but, like...
Yeah, no, I think we've seen plenty of evidence that a force sensitive being is naturally good at things.
Yeah, it's just what happens. But and then like her training that she even does go through, like with Leia, like the fact that we even get that is amazing. Like just the idea of that alone, that like, and the implications that Leia laid down her lightsaber for, you know, getting that through, you know, getting that knowledge through that too. Like I don't know, and her give, you know, Leia like giving Rey her lightsaber. Or like not giving, but like giving the light, giving Luke's lightsaber officially, yeah. And like passing it on, like kind of not like she's like one day I'll earn this, but like Leia is, it's also like kind of like I may not see you, like she's, I don't know, like I don't know how to take that scene. It's like she's handed it off kind of like the last time, mm-hmm. And like she knows sort of, and like I give this to you, like I don't know, like she kind of, I don't know, it does seem that like she knows this is like the last kind of passing
it's
of it.
The last time we'll see each other, sort of. Yeah.
But no, Rey is still of the mindset of like, I will earn this someday. She's like, this still isn't mine. Like, it's not mine. I will earn this someday. And that's, I don't know. I can't wait to see what she does with the new Jedi Order, because I couldn't think of like a better, like someone who's involved with so many different families and like she has so much conflict with her, but she was like, not around any of it, you know, kind of like Anakin at first, like has so much chosen one and all this stuff bringing him up, but he's just on Tatooine, a slave, and no one knows about him, you know, and that's how Rey started. And, I don't know. It's just, those stories are just, they, it works well, you know, it's what the prequels were written, you know, all about. And I think it's kind of, we got like all of that sped up. We got like the prequels and the OT for Rey.
Yeah.
But yeah, she
hero sort of thing going on.
Quite
there.
The climb. Let's see. I guess she was at, let's see, last year or last time she was at 67. So yeah, criminal. Very criminal. I see that as criminal now. But yeah, 12.
Yeah, last year I had her at 13, and I had Anakin at 12. So she's made the leap over Anakin now. Since
there you go.
But yeah, she won't be this episode for me. So that'll be a nice little,
I figured as much.
Nice,
yeah.
nice little one there. But my 12, I'm going to stick with the powerful women. I'm going with Padme Amidala here. That's where Padme goes for me. I love me some Padme. Mm-hmm. She's just a resilience defining force. You know, I think that her children just get so much from her without ever having met her.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think that Leia inherits her. You know, her kindness and her disposition to diplomacy and all this stuff from her mother. And I think Luke gets the same, you know, his kindness and his well-being. Like they get so much from their mom. And I think that Padme doesn't get enough credit for that sort of thing. You know, it's why I love some of the books, you know, it's why I love the book Bloodline. Leia actually mentions Padme and thinks about Padme and is like, that was my mother. And I never met her, but I know that I got a lot from her. And
even in the original trilogy, like, don't Luke and Leia like actually have a moment of like, what do you remember about our mother? And Leia's like, I remember that she was kind and beautiful. And like, I don't know. It was just like, that was it. You know, that was like all they ever mentioned, I think, in like the original trilogy. Yeah. But no, it's definitely like, they definitely got a lot passed down from her, and it's just such a, like, I mean, obviously you look at Darth Vader, like obviously they didn't get, you know, the Darth Vader tendencies, but of the Anakin, you know, before he was Darth Vader, yeah, and stuff like Anakin. But definitely the more empathetic parts come from Padme, that's yeah. For sure. Yeah. Without a doubt.
Well, that's what's interesting about Leia is that she gets a lot from Padme, but she gets a lot from Anakin too, like the headstrong go running into battle, guns ablazing, ready to do what needs to be done. I know that Padme was like that too, but Anakin fought in wars and stuff. He had a lot more examples of that being the case. But yeah, man, I love me some Padme Amidala. I think that Padme Amidala Naberi, it's her actual last name. Whoa. Amidala was her picked last name for when she became queen, because it's like an anonymous thing. Nobody knew that they were electing Padme Naberi as their queen. They knew they were electing Queen Amidala.
Huh?
Yeah.
What is? So it's like they're electing someone they don't even know?
They enter a race under the name they are going to use as their queen name. Supposed to be off planet. Padme Nauberry was off planet doing other things while Queen Amidala was reigning, that her family couldn't be harmed, so that things don't happen to the people she loves. It's an incredibly objective way to hold elections.
Wow. Okay.
Nobody knows that she's Padme Nauberry. They know she is Queen Amidala, which is why it also works that she can have handmaidens who can step in for her because it's just Queen Amidala. It's not Padme. It's kind of all of them, and it's a cool little system they got working there. But yeah, Padme Nauberry became Padme Amidala Nauberry. And wouldn't have that name unless she became queen.
Well, I did not know that before today at all. Mm-hmm. Every time. But okay, we're at the tippy top of this tier, I guess, this episode. And, right?
Yeah, this will be the last one for the episode.
I just wanted to make sure. Because I'm building him up because he deserves it, and this is quite the big character. I had him in the top 10 at first, and then I don't know, but he's close to getting there, and maybe next season he will. But this is where I have Cassian Andor for me, and I was really debating like going hard the top 10 here because he's one out from the top 10, and I was debating on how much, like, time that I spent with a character matters versus how much I just, like, fuck with the character arc of someone, you know?
Right.
And Cassian has just, I mean, that's what the first season of Andor is. It's his character arc. And it's beautiful. It's a masterpiece. It is masterfully written. It is amazing. And also in Rogue One, you know, like, as I don't know, he does very good there. I mean, I like him way more for Andor, and that's where my love for him has grown the most. And I don't know. I did have him quite high up at first, and then I think he has. That's the thing. He's 11 now,
right?
And the only people who are above him that are sort of newer, is really just Mando, like the new Mando people, and like that's it. But everyone else is established long legacy characters pretty much for me. And if he's already here now at 11, I mean, I'm without a doubt that he could become like one of my favorite, like top five.
Yeah. Shit.
Like, so I see him only going up from here. And I just, it feels wrong to not have him in the top 10, and I'm going to say some names that will probably piss some people off my top 10, but it's my top 10.
It's your top 10 about these characters.
And it's just more for,
no, it's preference. Yeah. You know, we're not talking about who the best characters in the world are, you know, it's
critically.
Just
yeah. He's like one, like critically, yeah. You know, like if you actually want to get like a character arc, like, I don't know, like maybe he actually could be one critically.
It could be up there for sure. But,
yeah, I guess that could,
I don't blame you for your preference.
I don't know. That could be a big take there. One critically of all of Star Wars. I've never really thought of that.
I mean, if we're appealing to a certain, if we're talking about a certain sect of the fandom, I have a feeling I have five people in my top 10 who, a lot of people would go,
Mary Sue. I see. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, like it's just, fuck them, you know, like it's all about what you want, you know, and I think that whatever you prefer is what you prefer, and having Cassian outside your top 10, hey man, I ain't gonna knock you. I do have him in my top 10 though. I'll have him next week, Thursday, May the 4th.
That's good,
but
though.
Yeah, to top off the episode officially, I'm gonna repeat one that you said earlier. This is where I have Bo-Katan Kryze. I got her climbing quite high after season 3 of The Mandalorian. Nice. An excellent character. Performed just wonderfully by Katie Sackhoff. And I loved the arc she went on in Mandalorian season 3. That the feeling down on herself, like she's not going to accomplish anything she's ever set out to do. She's given up hope, and then it's reignited, and she retakes Mandalore with the help of her people. Just an awesome, awesome character, and I love her. I love her, man. And don't have a ton to say about her. Like you said, she's been all over the Clone Wars, been all over Rebels. She's been everywhere, man. She's a big character throughout the history of Mandalore. And I'll always like that character. I'll never forget that after Satine died, whenever Obi-Wan like says goodbye to her and is like, "She was your sister, wasn't she?" And she just kind of like sits there and he goes, "I'm so sorry." And then like, just like, dude. And like, you could tell that's like a big turning point for Bo-Katan. That sort of like the death of her sister, you know, she was a Death Watch Mandalorian. She was fighting against what her sister had established for the rule of Mandalore. And it changed her perspective. It changed the way that she thought. And now she's become the ruler that I think her sister would proud to see her be, you know, and I think that's really important. Wish the show would have keyed in on it a little bit more, but that's okay.
A thing I think I was a little, I want to kind of, now that I've sat with the season completely, I'm kind of going back, and how I thought about it was kind of wrong. And I'm like, I want Den to take the helmet off for him to realize his faith is wrong, all of this, blah, blah, blah. But like, I'm kind of, just because that's how I think. You know, like, I am not religious really myself, so I'm wanting Den to go more that route. And that's kind of wrong. I shouldn't have really thought that way. Like, it's not wrong that he is still, like, believing in his faith. And, like, and now that Bo is kind of even, I don't know, she sees kind of some things in like, I don't know, the Mythosaur. She saw that changed her worldview a whole lot, the way that she thinks of things. She was thinking about keeping her helmet on, you know, like, when the armor told her, take her helmet off. She was like, I don't know.
You okay with
like,
that, dog?
I like, are you like, I, it was kind of interesting whether it was like, are you okay with that? Like, I don't know if I want to take my helmet off, you know, like, I don't like, it might've been like an inner conflict sort of thing, which is interesting. But I think, her, just, it was very, you know, there were a lot of religious cues in this season, without a doubt. And I think it's just, now that I've looked at it all, and just, I think it's just Jon Favreau, like, his life just kind of coming through. I think, like, it's pretty clear. I don't know if it is, and I don't want to, like, just kind of bring this discussion up out of nowhere, but, like, it just feels like it's very, like, a Jewish, like, a lot of Jewish, I guess, or just story, like, elements were popping up in this. Like, the covering of their face is kind of similar to just the headpieces they wear, and allowed to take them off, even if they're like alone, which is like an interesting thing that I didn't think about, is like Den doesn't even take his helmet off when he's alone, because he's like that, like, faithful to it. Like, even like some, when he eats and stuff like that, he'll take it off, but like he still doesn't like to take it off even at all. Like, even when he is alone, you know, it still feels like bad. And like, I don't want to like discredit like just their faith and everything.
No,
like that.
Yeah,
like,
that's what's interesting is that, like, that's what we viewed as cultish in previous watches. I mean, like, it's reflective of my own opinions of organized religion. I don't think, like, that's all that is, you know, because like, there's a lot of religious parallels for, or like religious orthodoxy. Like, it's just very traditional, very by the book, you break this rule, you're a sinner sort of thing, you know, like that's how a lot of religions work. You know, I think there's a lot of Christianity that bleeds through. I think there's a lot of Judaism that bleeds through. Islam, man, like, there's the whole, like, modern Muslim women are like required to cover everything but their hands and face.
I guess, maybe, and it isn't like, just solely just like that. I guess that's fair. It is more of just maybe like a general scope on world religion, you know, like how, like, because I think, like, I don't know, I feel like they're definitely trying to tell some like a story there. Like, it's, and I think that's going to be what season four will kind of be. I think they're going to dive a little deeper into that. Like, and I guess we were very subverted from where we thought the season was going. So maybe they will go a completely different direction, and maybe they don't touch that because it is kind of, you know, up in the air, and people don't like to have, you know, it's just a hard topic to talk about. People don't like to talk about religion whatsoever.
Right.
But it, I don't know, the stories that do come from it, like, could just spark some interesting, just, I don't know, conversations between the factions and stuff like that. And just see how they, I don't know what they're, what they really think, but, but I don't know, Bo's at the leading, you know, she's leading that now. She's like, I don't know. I really hope that she just goes around, finds any Mandalorian that's kind of left, you know, that's still mercenary or, you know, kind of still just not, I don't know, doing their own thing, but giving them the opportunity, like, hey, Mandalore's open, like, come back home, you know, sort of thing.
Right.
And I wonder, like, what that'll be. Have, like, their own version of, like, how Obi-Wan sent out that message of, like, don't return to the temple. It is not safe, you know, like, do not come back. It's, like, the opposite of, like, Mandalore is safe. Like, do come back. It is not poisonous. It's
open now, yeah.
And I don't know. I really hope we see, like, her just plant, like, just all those just native plants again, like all around the planet to like rebuild the surface somehow. I don't know. Could be really cool. Like we could see some like terraform, like Star Wars, like just what we would want to do as a species, you know, like what if we could go to Mars and just bring all the plants back and stuff like that. Like we could actually just see Bo do that on Mandalore, you know, like straight up, which is kind of what sci-fi is like all of it. It's to give people like inspiration and stuff is like we could get to this maybe one day. It does seem sci-fi now, but like I don't know, it's not that out there, and it's we don't need to do these things on the grand scale that they're doing them, but just if the we follow the principles, you know, of that. But
yeah, no, that's yeah, man. I love me some Bo. I think that she's going to be a great leader of Mandalore, and whatever they choose to do with her story in the future, I'm 100% here for.
A king and a queen, topping off the list, Cassian and Bo. Here or this episode, so
got us some royalty up at the top here, but yeah, man, that'll conclude this part six of the top 100, leaving us only with our top 10. If you want to, let's run it down real quick. I'll go first. At 11, I had Bo-Katan Kryze. 12, Padme Amidala. 13, Lando Calrissian. 14, Qui-Gon Jinn. 15, Anakin Skywalker / Darth Vader. 16, Ben Solo / Kylo Ren. 17, Finn. 18, Jyn Erso. 19, Dr. Aphra.
11, I had Cassian Andor. 12, I had Rey Skywalker. Come at me. Fuck you if you're mad about that. 13, I have Ben Solo / Kylo Ren. 14, Padme Amidala.
Naburi.
Naburi. I got to remember that. That's really cool. 15, Bo-Katan Kryze. 16, Han Solo. 17, Qui-Gon Jinn. 18, Maul. And 19, Ezra Bridger.
Hell of an episode there, man. I loved every character named. Love all of them. Those are all fantastic, and it leaves us with nothing but the top 10. And I cannot wait for May the 4th, where we will be giving that top 10 to you all. It's a wonderful, wonderful top 10 for me. I'm feeling so, so good about it. And I, like, I'm just looking at it, and like, these are my favorite characters in Star Wars at the moment. They make me also very, very happy, and I'm so excited to talk about them. But yeah, with that, we will conclude this episode of the Penny Bloom Podcast. We will be back tomorrow with the Ahsokast, our Ahsoka Tano coverage podcast, where we are talking arcs from the Clone Wars, Rebels, et cetera, Mandalorian, everything. We've already done the Clone Wars movie, and tomorrow is the first arc of the Clone Wars, the Malevolence arc, episodes 2-4 in season 1. Just the very first arc of the Clone Wars. It's a very, very compelling one, and it's a big one for Ahsoka. And that's tomorrow, Thursday. Like I said, we continue our top 100 Star Wars characters with the top 10 for us, and that's a very exciting one. I cannot wait for y'all to hear that. Friday, we continue our comic book movie journey through film with X2, X-Men 2, X2, X-Men United, I believe, is what the subtitle there is. That's a very exciting one. Excited for you to hear that. And then with that, if you would, head to patreon.com/pennybloompod, where you'll find over 50 hours of exclusive content, including all sorts of comic book reviews, book reviews, movie reviews, and the like. I'm writing again, and I'm about to do a Better Call Saul review that'll be posted up here before long. Very excited about that. And for $3 a month, you can support this podcast financially, which is huge because it costs me money and I don't make any off of it unless it's over there. Head to Twitter, follow at Penny Bloom Pod, follow on Instagram at Penny Bloom Podcast. I was Colton Robertson. I was joined by Joseph George. Thank you very much, homie.
Oh, thank you for having me. It's always a pleasure to be here.
Oh, and it's always a pleasure to have you. And remember, peace, love, and bloom, and rebellions are built on hope.